I will start today on this graph and stay on this graph for a bit, because there's a lot of explanation on this graph, and I truly believe that a lot of understanding of compliance can be generated by discussing this graph. Okay, it's not in Guyton, and there is one conceptual problem for undergraduates when you look at that Guyton diagram. If I can just switch back to that, let's hope this works. Yeah. Can you see the y-axis of this diagram? And it says lung volumes change in liters, okay? So when you look at this zero, this may off throw you if you don't read the word change. So actually he's talking about delta V. He's not talking about volume only. He's talking about volume change. So there is no volume change at zero. And as you go up the ladder of the y-axis, there is change in volume. This is what I have explained to you. But the untrained eye can overlook this and just look at the liters. Okay, so this word change is crucial. It's actually delta V. This is sometimes missed. Okay, and maybe an examiner can play with this and say, why is there a zero here at the base of the volume? Is the lung at zero volume? Obviously not, because we are dealing with delta V. However, this diagram, not in Guyton, but very descriptive and very nice. Just have a look around this diagram. Look at the x-axis, then the y-axis, then again the top x-axis. So he has given all the data required for transpulmonary pressure, pleural pressure. So now you can see it's the same thing really. The graph is plotted, the same graph can be plotted by either referring to the x-axis on top, which is a pleural pressure, okay, something that I was discussing yesterday, and the transpulmonary pressure at the bottom. It's really the same thing. Y-axis is lung volume. However, look at how he has depicted lung volume. So this is something that I really like about this diagram. TLC is total lung capacity, something that you don't know, but I'm telling you that it means what is the total amount of air that can be filled inside the lung maximally is referred to as TLC. Just log that away for now. Let's not get into the details. So the maximum amount of air that you can fill your lung with, maximum, okay, to the brim, is called TLC. Total lung capacity, okay? On the y-axis in this diagram, he has given the change in volume as a function of TLC. So as a fraction of TLC, as a percentage of TLC. So this 25 is actually 25% of total lung capacity. 50% is 50% of total lung capacity, and so on and so forth, to give you a sense of an actual lung, okay? Rather than a delta V with no context. And this morning I was referring to the text of the new Guyton. He does not mention any introduction about the lung that diagram is made on. Okay, so it can be off-throwing. So here we have taken a lung and we've plotted a graph, and the volume is a function of its total TLC. So as you go above from point zero to above, you know that in real time what is happening to this lung. Okay, so at 0 point, this lung is 0% of its TLC, which means it's collapsed. Yes, important point. Can a lung in vivo ever be collapsed normally? Normally, not as a consequence of an accident or a penetrating injury, wo to injury hogi na. Normally, would you want a collapsed lung? Well, no. Let's argue this out. Let's say, and this is a good way to understand this one. Let's say during expiration, somehow our lungs were designed in a way that in expiration, all the air, we were able to exhale all the air out. no air is left behind. Yeah, then would collapse, right? And then during the next ensuing inspiration, you would make a extra effort and inflate this collapsed lung, and so on and so forth. What is the immediate criticism that comes to mind of this model? But this model can exist. It doesn't exist, but it can exist theoretically, right? What's wrong with this scenario?
First communication would be negative.
Let's say, Uncha.
First communication would be negative.
Nuksan kya bete? Nuksan kya? Ji? Energy zyada lagegi bete. Energy zyada lagegi. We have been talking about this, that a measly amount of energy is required for the respiratory cycle to go on at rest. Really negligible. Imagine the total currency, the total budget of energy, and the body calculates, okay, what is required for thinking? What is required for heart? What is required for GIT, respiration? Respiration really takes up a very small amount of energy budget because it's very efficient, because it's made very efficient. How? This is one of the how, that you keep an amount of, ye sun lo achhi tarah, you keep an amount of air always inside the lung. It is referred to as residual volume. Residual volume. Why? Work of breathing. Okay? So there's always lung inflation. Lung is always inflated at all times of the respiratory cycle. During inspiration, obviously, but even at your maximal effort of expiration, you cannot bring the lung volume down to zero. You can bring it down, but you can't bring it down to zero. Aap jo chahe kar rahe, it's designed in the way that some air will always be, which will always stay there so that it doesn't collapse, so that in the next inspiration, you don't have this problem of inflating lung from zero volume up. Something that we will see, that when you have to do that, what happens? It comes with a caveat. This whole setup. It's a very difficult point to answer. There's a caveat, there's a problem in this setup. Nothing is perfect. There's a compromise. So the benefit you know not. But in this whole setup, there is a problem. Any idea what the problem might be? Suppose normal. You have residual volume sitting there. You can't get rid of it because then all of these things, just as I explained, happens. However, in this whole setup, there is one issue. Ji? Very good. I wouldn't say dead air. Dead space meaning it is stale air. It's stale, basi air. It's not fresh, because imagine, you take air in, you breathe air out, yes? Some of it is left inside the lung. What is that air? That air was part of the original air that oxygen was extracted from and carbon dioxide was put in it. But it had to stay back because of this noble thing of let's not collapse the lung thing. It sacrificed. However, it's sitting there as stale air. So now you breathe in fresh air, it gets mixed with that stale air. Right? So you have just taken a fresh breath, full of oxygen, very low on carbon dioxide, you know, normal air. But where does it go? It goes inside the lung where the residual volume is sitting, all stale and blue and angry. Right? It mixes with that air. So, you know, the dilutions then happen. This meeting is recorded now, then what were we doing initially? You better, sorry. This is the design of the lung. It's not about age. It's about the mechanics of lung. If you have taken air in and left and gas exchange has happened, and now you exhale air, but not the complete air. So some of it is left for this non-collapsing reason. This air is stale, okay? And if I can give you a stat, of course, body doesn't leave it like that. There is a contingency, a backup plan for this as well. Every 16 or something breaths refreshes this air. You keep on breathing, obviously this air will also, because it's air, it will also recycle. But every 16 or so breath pay, it will get replenished. Rahegi is stale. It will be stale air. It won't reflect the fresh air that you have breathed in. However, this is the balance that the body, that the lung strikes. That if you want to save energy, you have to give this this small sacrifice. Anyway, now this information is pretty compressed information spread along, I think, 2-3 chapters of Gaitan. But it has to be said here, in my opinion, because we are studying compliance. And in compliance, we will start with the collapsed lung to show you the problems of inflating a collapsed lung. You will not be able to appreciate the problems that can come when you inflate a collapsed lung if you are not shown it, or if you are only shown what is happening right now with you. Your lungs are on which type of compliance? Dynamic compliance. Dynamic compliance in this diagram is shown. Can you guess which part of the graph it's shown? Yeah. Inspiratory curve, compliance curve, expiratory compliance curve. This is dynamic compliance. This is how efficient your lungs are because of that sitting volume in it that doesn't let it collapse. The big diagram is inflating the lung from almost collapsed situation or very, very collapsed situation or nearly collapsed situation, as we will just start to discuss. I'm just giving you the preamble here. And look at the dynamic compliance graphs. The small, you can hardly look at it, see it. But this is where your lung is actually right now. It's very, it deals with small change in volumes, but very, very, very efficient. And if you look closely, the inspiratory curves of the blue and the green type are very different. In the dynamic compliance, there are no phases. So it seems, and it's true, that in dynamic compliance, as in us right now, there is not much going on against inflation of the lung. However, when you meddle with the affairs of the lung, you collapse it, then all sorts of demons come up, which you have to then fight against. And because of which, the inspiratory curve then becomes distorted. So originally, it should be like this. It should be almost like the expiratory curve, very smooth, no phases. But when you collapse it and then inflate it, it does get inflated, of course. It will get inflated, but look at the amount of effort that goes into, and look at how the graph is distorted because of that effort. Look at the blue line, I'm just talking about the inspiratory curve now, and look at the green dynamic compliance, the bottom green arrow. Line, inspiratory curve. There is no comparison between the two. Okay? So with this perspective, let's talk about inflating a lung, which is either fully collapsed or partially collapsed. Okay? If I talk about here, it's at zero change. We have no data that what was the start of this experiment. This graph was obviously plotted by an experiment. Okay, they were trying to do something here, show compliance. But in what type of air, in what type of lung, we don't know. It doesn't say in the text. It's quite frustrating. However, let's take a cadaveric lung. A dead person's air.
or dead person's lung, connect it with an air source, and do the experiment which we did yesterday. Inflate it one bit at a time, and at the same time of pressure change, let's look at how the volume changes, shall we? Let's do that on the cadaveric lung. Or you will say, okay, if it's cadaveric lung, is there a real life situation where you can have this situation? Can you? Can there be a real life situation where there's a lung collapse? Gunshot wound, you were in the emergency, remember? We started this whole thing when you were in the ER and there was a gunshot wound victim. That comes into play now. Yesterday's lecture is, this lecture is a continuation of yesterday's lecture, okay? So you are in the ER, gunshot guy comes in, lung collapse on one side. Now what to do? His lung is like a khajur, all contracted and inside. And air or blood or pus, whatever, is filling the place where the lung used to be. Now what do you do? What do you do? You put in a tube and you take out whatever is in there. If it's air or blood or whatever, you take it out one bit at a time. Why not just suck it out like that? Because that might damage the lung. So you drain the stuff which has abnormally gone in because of that injury. You drain it. You bring it out bit by bit. So literally this part, you're recreating this part. You're making it more negative. Or transpulmonary pressure is becoming now positive. So lung will start to expand one bit at a time. And then when you have gotten all the stuff out, it's okay. The lung is now back to its full glory, its full volume. Yes? This is the real life explanation of the collapsed lung scenario. Okay? So whether that works for you in your mind or the cadaveric lung, it's up to you. You have to imagine something. Either imagine a collapsed lung of the cadaver or imagine a pneumothorax, an injury where the lung has collapsed and you are the one who is doing the deflating. And if cadaveric lung works for you, then you are the one who is pumping air in. Either way, it's up to you, right? So look at the blue lines now. Look at the blue line of the inspiratory compliance curve. Look at the phases. We have done those phases in the last class. So I'll just quickly revise it for you. There are four phases, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Do you see these four phases? The first is where there is minimal change in volume while the pressure is really changing because the graph is horizontal to the x-axis. So you are increasing pressure, in this case, transpulmonary pressure. You're increasing it, but not much is happening because lung is collapsed. Or nearly collapsed. Why do I keep saying nearly collapsed? Why can't I just say it's fully collapsed? Look at the TLC. It's not hitting rock bottom at zero. There's still something there. So I can't say that. I have to put this bit in that it's nearly collapsed. Okay. So from this point onwards, we have either put in a probe to pump air in. Or in the pneumothorax example, start to get air out from the pleural cavity, whatever. The lung, how does it respond? Initially, it does not respond. Look at the volume change. No volume change, it's horizontal, it's flat. What is happening here? We'll talk about it. Somebody sitting here yesterday mentioned surface tension. So surface tension and that good old elastic recoil. It's all angry and red. You have taken residual volume out of the lung, didn't you? So it's compressed. The elastic recoil is at its peak, and so are the surface tension forces, which we'll discuss in a bit. So this lung, you are trying to inflate by putting pressure in. Obviously, it won't respond to you. But till what time would it not respond? After a while, the pressure that you have kept on increasing, so you gave it pressure here, then here, no volume change. Then again, more pressure, no volume change, more. Around here, the pressure becomes too much for the surface tension forces and the elastic recoil forces. So it gets defeated a bit, these two negative forces. So the pressure now slightly succeeds in inflating the lung. Hence, you see that the graph goes up. You have, finally, you have volume change with pressure change. Are you with me? Okay. And as soon as you hit a critical volume here, up till here, the inflation is such that now whatever volume of pressure or amount of pressure you put in, it will directly lead to change in volume. It's literally like inflating a new, brand new balloon. Have we inflated a brand new balloon sometimes in our life? It's brand new, it's collapsed. It's brand new, it's come out of a shopper of compressed balloons. So just do it slowly. In your mind, inflate it very slowly. Initially the breath, the molecules of air that you put in, where do they go? They go inside the balloon, but does it result in equal volume change? No. Okay, so at first, the whole surface of the balloon is literally, it's like this. So initial molecules just break that up. No significant volume change happens. Then what happens? You put in more air. Remember, you're doing this slowly, not fast. Then more particles go in. They slightly bulge it out, the walls of the balloon. It's still not tight. The wall is not tight. It's dilly. It's very flabby. Then you put more air in. Then one point comes, and you know that if you have inflated a balloon. One point comes when the wall is taut. Now, when you put any air in, it will expand exactly in line with your molecules, your breath. Yes, people are happy because I think they inflated a balloon on a happy occasion. People are happy. She's happy. A couple of smiley faces. It's good to see smiley faces. Okay. This is exactly what's happening in the lung. Almost exactly. Okay. So you trace three up. Look at the arrows. Very nice. The arrows are there. So it's like this. This diagram is like this. And remember, if you're asked to make a diagram of compliance, for Allah's sake, don't make it like this. Make it like this. Inspiratory. Then bring it down from there. The examiner is watching you. The examiner is watching all your shenanigans there. Bring it down from the top back and then make the expiratory curve. Because this is how this diagram is made. First, we inflate the thing, then we deflate it. The same thing. It's not two lungs here. So fourth point is when you hit maximum, you can't put any more air in. It's full. It's maxed out. 100% TLC has been achieved. Look at the y-axis. You've done it. Now you plot the expiratory curve and it comes back very smoothly, no phases. This is where the question was raised yesterday of the chocolate variety, if I remember. Where is my Kit Kat? Where's the gap? Where's CR? CR. CR, aap bhi mashallah kafi mukhtalif jagahon pe baithte hain. It's like the cat who changes how many houses? Seven? Ji bete, where is my Kit Kat? CR. Where is that guy? Ab kisi ne aati uthana. Aaj stage hai aapki. Aaj chalo. Aapko exempt kiya jata hai aaj. But I will require that Kit Kat sometimes soon. Okay? Where was I? See, Kit Kat distracts me. Expiratory compliance curve does not fall on the inspiratory compliance curve. There is a difference. This difference is called, we actually have a name for it. The distance between these two lines is called hysteresis. Hysteresis is the difference between inspiratory compliance curve and expiratory compliance curve. Why is it important? Because of all of these reasons. The forces that you get to fight against in inflating the lung are not present there in expiration. Nothing is present there. I'll say it like the nth time, the lung likes to recoil back. And what are you doing during inspiration? You're helping it recoil. So no resistance happens. Hence the curve is one smooth curve like this. Okay. Now, if I tell you that hysteresis in a lung is large and hysteresis in another lung is small. You see how questions are made? So we won't obviously ask you the FSC style, define hysteresis. No, we won't. We will put it in an application form. We will design the question in a way, hopefully, inshallah, that gets your analytical mind working. So this is the scenario. Scenario number one, this lung A, hysteresis a lot. Lung B, hysteresis very small. Big differences in these two lungs. Yes? Now your mind should work. What's going on? More hysteresis, less hysteresis. What is this? And so on and so forth. This is the application of hysteresis. I won't give you the answer. You work it out yourself. Now, just compare the blue curves, by the way, referred to as which type of compliance? Kisne kaha? Well done. Static compliance. This is static compliance. Guyton discusses static compliance without mentioning the word. So if you are not dealing with the normal in vivo lung, you're dealing with a static compliance scenario. Collapsed lung, cadaveric lung, pneumothorax, etc., etc. These are all, if you are regaining the volumes of lung, you are doing a static compliance maneuver. If you're studying in vivo lung, normal in vivo lung, you are dealing with the green small curves, referred to as dynamic compliance. Yes? And quickly see the features of the green curves. They are very, very similar. Small hysteresis, almost negligible. The whole thing is very negligible. What does that tell you? In this whole big diagram, the green thing is so small. The hysteresis is so small. The curves are so similar. This gives you a lot of information, hopefully. So if both curves are the same, this means that there is not much resistance to inflating this lung. Of course, expiring is not a problem anyway, but inspiration does bring up something naughty in the lung if it's collapsed. In this case, it's not, and it's small. Why are the curves small, so small? Is it then the case that we only require a little amount of volume change right now in dynamic situation while we are alive? Yes. You know how much air you take in on an average at rest? It's referred to as tidal volume. How much air? 500 ml. 500 ml is the amount of air required. 500 ml is the amount of volume that you inspire normally. I am doing more because I am exerting. You are doing nothing. You're sitting. So your tidal volume is at 500 ml approximately. 500 ml is a very small amount of air. Hence, look at the dynamic compliance curve. That's why it's so small. It's very small. Only 500 ml change. And then when you exhale 500 ml. Is it the same air, same 500 ml that you inspired? No, that's not the same. And this is where all sorts of areas of the lung comes from. Anyhow, is there anything left? Are there any questions? Questions? Ji. Ah, shabash. Very good. आपने ये भी नहीं पूछा बेटे, आप लोग पूछते नहीं हो ना, पूछते नहीं हो. I have to literally find out questions for you. So one question should have been FRC, functional residual capacity. Again, we will deal with it when we deal with it. You did not comment on the red line. You didn't ask me a red line horizontal. Why? What is it doing in the middle? You did not ask me that the green curves are sitting on top of the red line. Could it be that the lung actually operates normally with this much air in it at all times? So if this is the dynamic curve and its inspiratory curve is originating from on top of the red line, goes up a bit and then comes back to the red line, What is it, this whole area then? This is the air that stays behind in the lung at all times. You don't disturb this whole thing while you are at rest. This is what's proven by this graph, is it not? Your dynamic compliance curves are sitting on top. They are not here, 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 here. They are on top of this red line labeled as FRC. FRC, I'm defining it now. FRC is the amount of air which is left behind after a normal breath, not forceful, normal breath. Yeah. This is it. So whatever is left behind in my lung right now is FRC. And my dynamic compliance curves are sitting on top of the FRC. It's very, very, very quiet because of this whole thing.
This is sometimes missed, okay? And maybe an examiner can play with this and say, why is there a zero here at the base of the volume? Is the lung at zero volume? Obviously not, because we are dealing with delta V. समझ आई है मैंने ये बात क्यों रेस किया आज सुबह ठीक है ना ये थोड़ा सा ऑफ थ्रोइंग हो जाता है राइट हाउएवर दिस डायग्राम नॉट इन राइटन बट वेरी डिस्क्रिप्टिव एंड वेरी नाइस जस्ट हैव अ लुक अराउंड दिस डायग्राम लुक एट द एक्स एक्सिस देन द वाई एक्सिस देन अगेन द टॉप एक्स एक्सिस सो ही हैज गिवन ऑल द डेटा रिक्वायर्ड फॉर ट्रांसपल्मोनरी प्रेशर pleural pressure. So now you can see it's the same thing really. The graph is plotted, the same graph can be plotted by either referring to the x-axis on top, which is the pleural pressure, okay, something that I was discussing yesterday, and the transpulmonary pressure at the bottom. It's really the same thing. So in one diagram, if you see it, I doubt that you'll be able to forget it. Y-axis is lung volume. However, look at how he has depicted lung volume. This is something that I really like about this diagram. TLC is total lung capacity, something that you don't know, but I'm telling you that it means when the what is the total amount of air that can be filled inside the lung maximally is referred to as TLC. Just log that away for now. Let's not get into the details. So the maximum amount of air that you can fill your lung with, maximum, okay, to the brim is called TLC, total lung capacity. Okay. On the y-axis in this diagram, he has given the change in volume as a function of TLC. So as a fraction of TLC, as a percentage of TLC. So this 25 is actually 25% of total lung capacity. 50% is 50% of total lung capacity, and so on and so forth, to give you a sense of an actual lung, okay, rather than a delta V with no context. And I actually this morning I was referring to the text of the new guy. He does not mention any introduction about the lung that diagram is made on, okay. So it can be off throwing. So here we have taken a lung and we've plotted a graph, and the volume is a function of its total TLC. So as you go above, from point zero to above, you know that in real time what is happening to this lung. Okay, so at 0 point, this lung is 0% of its TLC, which means it's collapsed. Yes, important point. Can a lung in vivo ever be collapsed? Normally, any, not as a consequence of an accident or a penetrating injury, wo to injury hogi na. Normally, would you want a collapsed lung? Well, no. Let's argue this out. Let's say, and this is a good way to understand this one. Let's say during expiration, somehow our lungs were designed in a way that in expiration, all the air, we were able to exhale all the air out. No air is left behind. Yeah? Then would collapse, right? And then during the next ensuing inspiration, you would make a extra effort and inflate this collapsed lung, and so on and so forth. What is the immediate criticism that comes to mind of this model? But this model can exist. It doesn't exist, but it can exist theoretically, right? What's wrong with this scenario? Anybody? जी बेटे आपने हाथ खड़ा किया? अच्छा नहीं जी. I with your class I just imagine कि हाथ खड़े हो गए. जी okay, that's good, that's a good point, great point. So in exercise, but I'm saying you're sitting down and every time you expire the lung goes to zero volume and then you inflate it from zero volume to whatever volume, normal volume. What's wrong with that? At rest, there's a huge wrong here, but what?
Transcranial pressure will be negative.
फिर से ऊंचा.
Transcranial pressure will be negative.
नुकसान क्या है बेटे? नुकसान क्या है? जी. एनर्जी ज़्यादा लगेगी बेटे. एनर्जी ज़्यादा लगेगी. We have been talking about this that a measly amount of energy is required for the respiratory cycle to go on at rest. Really negligible. Imagine the total currency, the total budget of energy, and the body calculates, okay, what is required for thinking? What is required for heart? What is required for GIT, respiration? Respiration really takes up a very small amount of energy budget because it's very efficient, because it's made very efficient. How? This is one of the how. That you keep an amount of, ye sun lo achhi tarah, you keep an amount of air always inside the lung. It is referred to as residual volume. Residual volume. So the lung never, should never hit zero volume normally in a normal person. No, it doesn't. It shouldn't. Why? Work of breathing. Okay? So there's always lung inflation. Lung is always inflated at all times of the respiratory cycle. During inspiration, obviously, but even at your maximal effort of expiration, you cannot bring the lung volume down to zero. You can bring it down, but you can't bring it down to zero. Aap jo chahe kar le, it's designed in the way that some air will always be, which will always stay there so that it doesn't collapse, so that in the next inspiration, you don't have this problem of inflating lung from zero volume up. Something that we will see that when you have to do that, what happens? Is this point clear? But it comes with a caveat, this whole setup. It's a very difficult point to answer. There's a caveat, there's a problem in this setup. Nothing is perfect. There's a compromise. So the benefit you know now, but in this whole setup, there is a problem. Any idea what the problem might be? Sab kuch normal hai. You have residual volume sitting there. You can't get rid of it because then all of these things, just as I explained, happens. However, in this whole setup, there is one issue. Yeah. Very good. I wouldn't say dead air, dead space meaning, it is stale air, it's stale, basi air, it's not fresh. Because imagine, you take air in, you breathe air out, yes? Some of it is left inside the lung. What is that air? That air was part of the original air that oxygen was extracted from and carbon dioxide was put in it. But it had to stay back because of this noble thing of let's not collapse the lung thing. It sacrificed. However, it's sitting there as stale air. So now you breathe in fresh air, it gets mixed with that stale air. Right? So you have just taken a fresh breath, full of oxygen, very low on carbon dioxide, you know, normal air. But where does it go? It goes inside the lung where the residual volume is sitting. all stale and blue and angry, right? It mixes with that air. Oh, so you know the dilutions then happen. This meeting is recorded now. Then what were we doing initially? You better sorry. Any, this is the design of the gun. It's not about age. It's about the mechanics of gun. If you have taken air in and left and gas exchange has happened, and now you exhale air, but not the complete air. So some of it is left for this non-collapsing reason. This air is stale. Okay? And if I can give you a stat, of course, body doesn't leave it like that. There's a contingency, a backup plan for this as well. Every 16 or something breaths refreshes this air. You keep on breathing, obviously this air will also, because it's air, it will also recycle. But every 16 or so breath pay, it will get replenished. Rahegi is stale. It will be stale air. It won't reflect the fresh air that you have breathed in. However, this is the balance that the body, that the lung strikes. That if you want to save energy, you have to give this this small sacrifice. Anyway, now this information is pretty compressed information, spread along, I think, 2-3 chapters of that. But it has to be said here, in my opinion, because we are studying compliance. And in compliance, we will start with the collapsed lung to show you the problems of inflating a collapsed lung. You will not be able to appreciate the problems that can come when you inflate a collapsed lung if you are not shown it, or if you are only shown what is happening right now with you. Your lungs are on which type of compliance? Dynamic compliance. Dynamic compliance in this diagram is shown. Can you guess which part of the graph is shown? Yeah. Inspiratory curve, compliance curve, expiratory compliance curve. This is dynamic compliance. This is how efficient your lungs are because of that sitting volume in it that doesn't let it collapse. The big diagram is inflating the lung from almost collapsed situation, or very, very collapsed situation, or nearly collapsed situation, as we will just start to discuss. I'm just giving you the preamble here. And look at the dynamic compliance graphs. The small, you can hardly look at it, see it. But this is where your lung is actually right now. It deals with small change in volumes, but very, very, very efficient. And if you look closely, the inspiratory curves of the blue and the green type are very different. In the dynamic compliance, there are no phases. So it seems, and it's true, that in dynamic compliance, as in us right now, there is not much going on against inflation of the lung. However, when you meddle with the affairs of the lung, you collapse it, then all sorts of demons come up, which you have to then fight against. And because of which, the inspiratory curve then becomes distorted. So originally, it should be like this. It should be almost like the expiratory curve. Very smooth, no phases. But when you collapse it and then inflate it, it does get inflated, of course. It will get inflated. But look at the amount of effort that goes into it. And look at how the graph is distorted because of that effort. Look at the blue line. I'm just talking about the inspiratory curve now. And look at the green dynamic compliance, the bottom green line, inspiratory curve. There is no comparison between the two. Okay? So with this perspective, let's talk about inflating a lung, which is either fully collapsed or partially collapsed. Okay? If I talk about Nikon, Nikon. एक साइड पीछे दो, हाँ नहीं और पीछे 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 बस. हियर इट्स एट जीरो चेंज. वी हैव नो डेटा दैट व्हाट वाज द स्टार्ट ऑफ दिस एक्सपेरिमेंट. दिस ग्राफ वाज ऑब्वियसली प्लॉटेड बाय एन एक्सपेरिमेंट. ओके दे वर ट्राइंग टू डू समथिंग हियर शो कंप्लायंस बट इन व्हाट टाइप ऑफ एयर इन व्हाट टाइप ऑफ लंग वी डोंट नो. इट डजंट से इन द टेक्स्ट. इट्स क्वाइट फ्रस्ट्रेटिंग. हाउएवर लेट्स टेक a cadaveric lung, a dead person's lung, connected with an air source, and do the experiment which we did yesterday. Inflate it one bit at a time, and at the same time of pressure change, let's look at how the volume changes, shall we? Let's do that on the cadaveric lung. Or you will say, okay, if it's cadaveric lung, is there a real life situation where you can have this situation? Can you? Can there be a real life situation where there is a lung collapse?
Yes.
Gunshot wound, you were in the emergency, remember? We started this whole thing when you were in the ER and there was a gunshot wound victim. That comes into play now. This lecture is a continuation of yesterday's lecture. Okay? So you are in the ER, gunshot guy comes in, lung collapse on one side. Now what to do? His lung is like a khajur, all contracted and inside. And air or blood or pus, whatever, is filling the place where the lung used to be. Now what do you do? You put in a tube. And you take out whatever is in there. If it's air or blood or whatever. You take it out one bit at a time. Why not just suck it out like that? Because that might damage the lung. So you drain the stuff which has abnormally gone in because of that injury. You drain it. You bring it out bit by bit. By the way, as soon as you put that tube in, you will actually hear the air coming out because you have given it a conduit. You have given it a way to exit. Because when the gunshot wound, the gun bullet entered the cavity, it obviously punctured the cavity, went inside, and it was obviously not a very neat and clean edge of the wound. It acted as a valve. So it got punctured like this, and then it sort of closed on its own. So there is now air trapped in. What you do is you put a tube. As soon as you put a tube, if it's air, it will start to ooze out, or whoosh out. If it's a fluid, it will start to come out. Yes? So you do that bit by bit, not actively, not like pulling it out or sucking it out. As you do it bit by bit, what do you think would happen to the lung which is collapsed in there? It would gradually expand. As much as the abnormal fluid, air, whatever is taken out and space is created, is regained inside that cavity, the lung will find it's okay, it's safe to expand, and it starts to expand. Because what are you creating in the pleural space? Negativity. You're pulling stuff out. You're creating negativity. Lungs like create negativity, and it starts to expand. Literally, what is... Okay, next new word. Half sugar. So literally, this part. You're recreating this part. You're making it more negative. Or transpulmonary pressure is becoming now positive. So lung collapse, lung will start to expand one bit at a time. And then when you have gotten all the stuff out, it's okay. The lung is now back to its full glory, its full volume. Yes? This is the real life explanation of the collapsed lung scenario. Okay? So whether that works for you in your mind or the cadaveric lung, it's up to you. You have to imagine something. Either imagine a collapsed lung of the cadaver or imagine a pneumothorax, an injury where the lung has collapsed and you are the one who is doing the deflating. And if cadaveric lung works for you, then you are the one who is pumping air in. Either way, it's up to you, right? So, look at the blue lines now. Look at the blue line of the inspiratory compliance curve. Look at the phases. We have done those phases in the last class. So I'll just quickly revise it for you. There are four phases. One, two, 3 and 4. Do you see these four phases? The first is where there is minimal change in volume while the pressure is really changing, because the graph is horizontal to the x-axis. So you are increasing pressure, in this case transpulmonary pressure, you are increasing it, but not much is happening because lung is collapsed or nearly collapsed. Why do I keep saying nearly collapsed? Why can't I just say it's fully collapsed? Look at the TLC. It's not hitting rock bottom at zero. It's still, there's still something there. So I can't say that. I have to put this bit in, that it's nearly collapsed, okay? So from this point onwards, we have either put in a probe to pump air in, or in the pneumothorax example, start to get air out from the pleural cavity, whatever. The lung, how does it respond? Initially, it does not respond. Look at the volume change. No volume change, it's horizontal, it's flat. What is happening here, we'll talk about. Somebody sitting here yesterday mentioned surface tension. Was it you? Somebody else, here. The surface tension person, is he here? Yes. Oh, what a change. So, aaj aapki hogi straight under hai. It's okay. Ye baat sab pe aata hai. So, surface tension and that good old elastic recoil. It's all angry and red. You have taken residual volume out of the lung, didn't you? So it's compressed, the elastic recoil is at its peak, and so are the surface tension forces, which we'll discuss in a bit. So this lung, you are trying to inflate by putting pressure in. Obviously, it won't respond to you. But till what time will it not respond? After a while, the pressure that you have kept on increasing, so you gave it pressure here, then here, no volume change, then again, more pressure, no volume change, more, around here, the pressure becomes too much for the surface tension forces and the elastic recoil forces. So then it gives, it gets defeated a bit, these two negative forces. So the pressure now slightly succeeds in inflating the lung. Hence you see that the graph goes up. You have, finally you have volume change with pressure change. Are you with me? Okay. And as soon as you hit a critical volume here, up till here, the inflation is such that now whatever volume of pressure, of amount of pressure you put in, it will directly lead to change in volume. It's literally like inflating a new, brand new balloon. Have we inflated a brand new balloon sometimes in our life? It's brand new, it's collapsed. It's brand new, it's come out of a shopper of compressed balloons. So just do it slowly. In your mind, inflate it very slowly. Initially the breath, the molecules of air that you put in, where do they go? They go inside the balloon, but does it result in equal volume change? No. Okay, so at first, the whole surface of the balloon is literally, it's like this. It's like as if somebody has put an adhesive in inside. It's decayed. So initial molecules just break that up. No significant volume change happens. Then what happens? You put in more air. Remember, you're doing this slowly, not fast. Then more particles go in. They slightly bulge it out, the walls of the balloon. It's still not tight. The wall is not tight. It's dilly. It's very flabby. Then you put more air in. Then one point comes, and you know that if you have inflated a balloon. One point comes when the wall is taut. Now when you put any air in, it will expand exactly in line with your molecules, your breath. Yes, people are happy. Because I think they inflated a balloon on a happy occasion. People are happy. She's happy. Oh, a couple of smiley faces. It's good to see smiley faces. Okay. This is exactly what's happening in the lung. Almost exactly. Okay. So you trace three up. Look at the arrows. Very nice. The arrows are there. So it's like this. This diagram is like this. And remember, if you're asked to make a diagram of compliance, for Allah's sake, don't make it like this. Make it like this. Inspiratory. Then bring it down from there. The examiner is watching you. The examiner is watching all your shenanigans there. Bring it down from the top, back, and then make the expiratory curve. Because this is how this diagram is made. First we inflate the thing, then we deflate it. The same thing. It's not two lungs here. So, fourth point is, when you hit maximum, you can't put any more air in. It's full, it's maxed out. 100% TLC has been achieved. Look at the y-axis. You've done it. Now, you plot the expiratory curve and it comes back very smoothly, no phases. This is where the question was raised yesterday of the chocolate variety, if I remember. Where's my Kit Kat? Where's the gap? Where's CR? CR? CR, aap bhi mashallah kafi mukhtalif jama baithte hain. It's like the cat. It changes how many houses? Seven? Ji bete, where is my Kit Kat? CR? Where is that guy? Ab kisi ne aake kaha? Aaj stage hai aapki. Aaj sir. Aapko exempt kiya jata hai aaj. But I will require that Kit Kat sometimes soon. Okay? Where was I? See, Kit Kat distracts me. Expiratory compliance curve does not fall on the inspiratory compliance curve. There is a difference. This difference is called, we actually have a name for it. The distance between these two lines is called hysteresis. Maybe spelling with all of them. Hysteresis. Hysteresis is the difference between inspiratory compliance curve and expiratory compliance curve. Why is it important? Because of all of these reasons. The forces that you get to fight against in inflating the lung are not present there in the expiration. Nothing is present there. I'd say it like the nth time, the lung likes to recoil back. And what are you doing during inspiration? You're helping it recoil. So no resistance happens. Hence the curve is one smooth curve like this. Yes? Okay, but so next time if you're asked in a bio about what is hysteresis, would it appear French to you? It shouldn't. Okay? Hysteresis is the difference between these two curves. Next question would be, what is the reason for hysteresis? You know the hysteresis reason today. Okay? Now, if I tell you that hysteresis in a lung is large and hysteresis in another lung is small, you see how questions are made? So we won't obviously ask you the FSE style, define hysteresis. No, we won't. We will put it in an application form. We will design the question in a way, hopefully, inshallah, that gets your analytical mind working. So this is the scenario. Scenario number one, this lung A, hysteresis a lot. Lung B, hysteresis very small. Big differences in these two lungs. Yes?
Yes.
Now your mind should work. What's going on? More hysteresis, less hysteresis. What is this? And so on and so forth. This is the application of hysteresis. I won't give you the answer, you work it out yourself. Now, just compare the blue curves, by the way, referred to as which type of compliance? Kisne kaha? Well done. Static compliance. This is static compliance. Guyton discusses static compliance without mentioning the word. So if you are not dealing with the normal in vivo lung, you're dealing with a static compliance scenario. Collapsed lung, cadaveric lung, pneumothorax, etc., etc. These are all, if you are regaining the volumes of lung, you are doing a static compliance maneuver. If you're studying in vivo lung, normal in vivo lung, you are dealing with the green small curves, referred to as dynamic compliance. Yes? And quickly see the features of the green curves. They are very, very similar. Small hysteresis, almost negligible. The whole thing is very negligible. What does that tell you? in this whole big diagram, the green thing is so small. The distance, the hysteresis is so small. The curves are so similar. This gives you a lot of information, hopefully. So if both curves are same, this means that there is not much resistance to inflating this lung. Of course, expiring is not a problem anyway, but inspiration does bring up something naughty in the lung if it's collapsed. In this case, it's not, and it's small. Why are the curves small, so small? Is it then the case that we only require a little amount of volume change right now in dynamic situation while we are alive? Yes. You know how much air you take in on an average at rest? It's referred to as tidal volume. How much air? 500 ml. 500 ml is the amount of air required. Bete, you don't talk. That was the deal, right? Don't talk, don't discuss, read whatever you want. 500 ml is the amount of volume that you inspire normally. I am doing more because I am exerting. You are doing nothing. You're sitting. So your tidal volume is at 500 ml approximately. 500 ml is a very small amount of air. Hence, look at the dynamic compliance curve. That's why it's so small. It's very small. Only 500 ml change. And then when you exhale 500 ml. Is it the same air, same 500 ml that you inspired? No, that's not the same. And this is where all sorts of areas of the lung comes from. Anyhow, is there anything left? Are there any questions? Questions? Ji. Shabash. Very good. Aapne ye bhi nahi pucha bete. Aap log poochte nahi ho na. Poochte nahi ho. I have to literally find out questions for you. So one question should have been FRC. Functional residual capacity. Again, we will deal with it when we deal with it. You did not comment on the red line. You didn't ask me a red line horizontal. Why, what is it doing in the middle? You did not ask me that the green curves are sitting on top of the red line. Could it be that the lung actually operates normally with this much air in it at all times? So if this is the dynamic curve and its inspiratory curve is originating from on top of the red line, goes up a bit and then comes back to the red line, what is it, this whole area then? This is the air that stays behind in the lung at all times. You don't disturb this whole thing while you are at rest. This is what's proven by this graph, is it not? Your dynamic compliance curves are sitting on top. They're not here. They are on top of this red line labeled as FRC. FRC, I'm defining it now. FRC is the amount of air which is left behind after a normal breath. Not forceful. Normal breath. Yeah. This is it. So whatever is left behind in my lung right now is FRC. And my dynamic compliance curves are sitting on top of the FRC. It's very, very, very quiet because of this whole thing. One thing that I would like to add here is nothing replaces personal study. If you don't study things, if you listen to me every morning with good intention, trying to understand stuff, you will retain what? About 30%, maximum 50% retain kar lo. But the rest you have to reinforce by studying yourself. And this stuff will take you to some fancy books. Because I am teaching you extra. Because this will help you later on. It will, trust me. So if you understand dynamic compliance today, you are investing in your future, literally. Okay? So difference between static and dynamic compliance, I ask my good students. Your baseline, UHS baseline material is whatever is written in guidance. We have done that, burnt it, and on top we have made a whole building now of the difference between static and dynamic compliance. And I expect the good students to know this, to retain it, to actually conceptualize it, and to be able to defend it in a while. Notes, what I've just discussed, you can have these slides. This is everything, all stages defined. Hysteresis at the bottom. Notes again, we have done all of this. However, there's some little stuff here. Static compliance gets defined on the same slide as dynamic compliance. So I think this is a very valuable slide for people who want to keep this understanding with them, the difference between static and dynamic compliance, okay? And let me at this point add something to dynamic compliance for those who are listening and want to understand. The forces that come into play in static compliance scenario are surface tension, elastic recoil. Add one more thing, resistance put up by the airways, airway resistance. So basically three things. Airway resistance we usually don't mention at your level, it's because it's very negligible, generally speaking. But let's talk about asthma, and airway resistance comes up big time. Because in asthma, we discuss that this is a big problem. Not in the parenchyma, the problem is in the airways. So you have to, if you want to complete the picture, really complete the picture, it's about surface tension, elastic recoil, airway resistance. Kapish? Yes? Static compliance has to deal with these three, all three, because you collapse the lung. Uske airways bhi collapse ho gaye. So the resistance of the airways you need to also take into play. That's why itni musibat padti hai isko clear karna. However, if you look at dynamic compliance, what is the only thing you need to worry about? Do you need to worry about surface tension? No. Look at the place of the curves. They are way above surface tension issues. Surface tension issues lie here somewhere. Even maximum recoil properties lie here somewhere. As you go up this ladder here, pressure leads to equal volume change. So, not a big issue. So, the green stuff lies above these problems. So, the only thing that it needs to really sort of, in a very small way, worry about is the third, airway resistance. So, check this out. We are really splitting hairs here. You inspired air and then you expired air. You are a molecule of air. You went in and now you're coming out. Would you have inertia? You have some weight, however minuscule it is. And you're not alone. Your entire class is there in a breath. You've gone into the lung, so you are being pushed. You're an air molecule, remember? You're being sucked into the lung. You're dropping like a free fall inside the lung. And now equally reverse forces are pushing you out. In, out. There will be inertia problems. Inertia problems when? When you are sucked out, or pushed out. Now, second year MBBS wants to go in. So they will find some first year molecules in there. Still on the outward path. You're really splitting and see it. Okay? So anyway, this is one of the issues if you really go deep into things. One issue is this inertia of air molecules. Number two is the caliber of the airways. If you remember airway resistance, this is enough. This is good. This is actually very good. If you only remember that dynamic compliance has to worry about airway resistance only, this is good enough, actually much better than good enough, okay? I had to bring in COPD, come on, you thought I would forget it? First, let's get the easy stuff out. What is the main issue in obstructive lung disease? Said it before, many times here, keep it, Trevor. Expiration because of changes in lung structure, architecture. Yes? What about restrictive lung disease? What is the problem in there? Somebody else. Inspiration is a problem, not much expiration. Because again, the lung has become stiff. The lung has become stiff in pulmonary fibrosis as an example of restrictive lung disease, yes? And over there, obstructive it is, it hasn't become stiff, it has become baggy, old soft. That old soft, remember that. Just really, really make it very, very old with holes in it. That's COPD lung, okay? Easy to put air in, but just imagine how will you pump it out. So comment on compliance in restrictive lung disease. I promise you I will give these questions. Aapko bata raha hoon, paper mein. I may give these questions. Go on, think. In restrictive lung disease, what will happen to static or dynamic compliance? Simon says they both decrease. Is Simon right? Maybe, maybe not. I won't give the answer. But Simon is really interested in what you have to say about COPD, obstructive lung disorder. And in fact, if you were listening, I gave you the answer, I think yesterday. If only you were listening. Static is increased. I will not expect. You have to do the due diligence now. By the way, it's all on the net, on the channel, in yesterday's lecture. I've described it. So remember, please, with understanding, that in obstructive disorder, COPD, static compliance increases. Because, again, it's my reflex, I start explaining things. Because you can accommodate air, and compliance is a measure of distensibility. That sock is old. Of course it's distensible. So of course it's static compliance is through the roof. The problem comes in dynamic compliance, because dynamic compliance relates to airflow, both in and out. I forgot mentioning it in the last slide. Dynamic compliance, one more sentence added. It's about airflow. If you forget everything else, remember, dynamic compliance is related with airflow, both in and out. So in COPD, this is a big problem, isn't it? Is distending the COPD lung a big problem? No, it's not. Expiring it, big problem. So if you are just looking at one parameter, the third parameter that I mentioned, not the surface tension, not the recoil, resistance to airflow. This is the kicker in COPD. You just can't get it out during expiration. So when you're measuring airflow on an average, in a COPD patient, airflow is decreased a lot. Yes or no? So if dynamic compliance relates with airflow, it goes down. Let's do the experiment and explain the experiment tomorrow. Tomorrow, class F?
Class F.
Fine. Let's just do an experiment and discuss it tomorrow. You take two lungs, inflate one lung with air, inflate the other lung with normal saline. Lung A, lung B. One you put a pipe which pumps in air in it, so it's inflated by air, normal. The other lung is inflated by normal saline. This experiment is given in Guyton. However, the wording is poor, so you will not understand what I'm saying, he's saying. I'm explaining that. You actually inflate the lung with normal saline, lung B. Do you understand it? The expansion of both lungs are given in graphical form here in this graph. This is a Guyton diagram. Very famous YouTube. What is the difference between compliance, I'm actually giving you the actual SEQ words here. What is the difference between the compliance of the air-filled lung as compared to the fluid-filled lung? Yeah, difference. Yes, I'm near. Probably has labeled it as well. Yes, so saline-filled lung compliance curve becomes this. Air-filled looks like normal. Because it's air-filled. Why does the saline-filled lung compliance curves look like that? what is the most clearly, even at the back, even the gentleman up there can see the one huge difference in between these two compliance curves. What is that? Say hysteresis. Hysteresis. The amount of hysteresis in the saline curve is very, very small. Don't you see? In the air, it's whatever it is. But in the saline filled lung, it's very small. Why? I think I will eventually eat it someday. In the last lecture, maybe. Why? Right? What does hysteresis depend on? Is what you should be thinking right now. I'm just curious, what would you say?
Sir, elasticity between the healthy though, it's a change in volume or change in pressure to metabolism, change in volume.
It occupies more space than
Okay. Yep. Let's see if I can throw this to you. Ah, still got it. Well done. Surface tension. My fellow humans, sapiens, surface tension. When you inflate a lung, theoretically speaking, with saline, you get rid of surface tension. And look at how the compliance shoots up of this lung. More in tomorrow's lecture. But this is the one line answer. You have deleted all surface tension possible in this lung. Hence, look at the compliance. It has really increased. So, the reverse can be said. Compliance gets affected by surface tension. By minusing it, by deleting it, compliance really shot up and above the normal compliance values. So, obviously, it means that surface tension is a big thing to overcome in a collapsed lung. Remember, both of these lungs were collapsed. When you took them out of the thoracic cage, obviously they were collapsed. The cadaveric lung was collapsed. One you inflated with air, the other you inflated with normal saline. So both had all of those issues that you had with the blue curves in the previous diagram. Shown here. So all of the surface tension, recoil, etc. Recoil is present in both. No? Did the water or did the normal saline affect the elastic fibers of the lung? No. What has that got to do with elastic fiber? The parenchyma is the same, okay? But something happened in the air, in the fluid field, which removed the surface tension. And that the results are clear to you. More on this, inshallah, tomorrow.